All right, well, we find ourselves there in Proverbs chapter number 29, and I want you to look at verse number 18. If you look at Proverbs 29 and look at verse number 18, we're going to look at a few other verses in Proverbs 29. Well, we're going to be all over the Bible this morning a little bit, mainly in the book of Proverbs. But look at verse number 18. The Bible says in Proverbs 29:18, "Where there is no vision, the people perish. But he that keepeth the law, happy is he." Now that's a very interesting verse and a very important verse in the Bible. The Bible says, when there is no vision, the people perish. That word vision there obviously has to do with sight. And God says, where people do not have a vision, and he's not talking about something you physically see with your eye, but he's talking about having a vision for the future, seeing something in the distance. And he says, where there is no vision, where people don't see something, where you don't have a goal maybe, he says, the people perish. Now I want to preach a sermon on this morning on the subject of parenting. And the title of the sermon is this, Purposeful Parenting. Purposeful Parenting. And one of the reasons we must have parenting that has a purpose behind it is because of Proverbs 29:18. The Bible says, where there is no vision, the people perish. And I feel like most people who have children this morning here in America or all over the world, and they're parenting children, they have no vision, or they have no purpose, or they have no goal for their children. They're just kind of going along life, they're just kind of going along the way, but they really don't have a goal for their life. And when we parent our children, we ought to have a purpose. Now you say, Pastor Jiménez, why are you preaching a sermon like this morning? Because, you know, when you think about it, it might alienate some people. You say, I'm not a parent. But the truth of the matter is, this sermon, first of all, the things we're going to talk about and the wise things from the Bible, they're going to apply in all sorts of areas of life. But really, a parenting sermon doesn't alienate a lot of people for this reason. Number one, you're either a parent, you know, and you have children. Or if you're not a parent, more than likely you will be a parent in the future, so you can learn these principles and just put them on, you know, on the back burner and bring them up and apply them with your children whenever God does give you children, you know, in the future when you get married or when you have kids, whatever. Or if you have grown parents, hey, you might be a grandparent who might be able to, you know, help your child be a better parent. Or a lot of times, you know, grandparents end up raising, you know, their grandkids as a parent. So really, this is something of value that everybody can learn. But the point is this, we must have a vision for our children. We must have a vision for our parents. The Bible says, where there is no vision, the people perish. Now, keep your finger there in Proverbs 29 and go with me back to the book of Psalms. And look at Psalm 45. I want you to see one verse in Psalm, and then we'll go back to Proverbs. Psalm 45, and look at verse 16. Psalm 45, 16, the Bible says this. Psalm 45, 16 is a wonderful verse. Psalm 45, 16, the Bible says, instead of thy fathers shall be thy children. Psalms is the book right before the book of Proverbs. Psalm 45, 16. Instead of thy fathers shall be thy children. And look at what it says, whom thou mayest make princes in all the earth. Isn't that an amazing verse? The Bible says, instead of thy fathers shall be thy children. And the Bible says, whom thou. Now, that thou is referring to the parent. That thou is referring to the father. Because he said, instead of thy fathers shall be thy children. And it says, whom thou, the parent, mayest make princes in all the earth. Isn't it amazing that the Bible says that a parent, a father, may make their child a prince. That's what the Bible says. And see, I don't think we realize as parents that we have the ability to make or to mold our children into something great. Here it says that the father whom thou mayest make princes, it says you can make your child a prince in all the earth. And I think we got to realize that when God gives us a child, he gives us this person who we have a responsibility to mold, and we have a responsibility to form, and we have a responsibility to make into something that is either going to make us very proud, and it's going to be great, and it's going to be something like a prince, or they might end up being a loser, or a derelict, or a criminal, based on how we parent them. And that's why I want to preach on this subject of having a vision for your children, because you have the power to make something of your child, or your grandchildren, or whoever allows you to influence them in their life. Most people have no goal for their children. They're just kind of going about their lives. And here's how I see most parents in America. I feel like most parents, just live with their children. You know, they feed them, they clothe them, they take care of them physically until the child is old enough to take care of themselves physically. But most people, there's no goal they have, there's nothing they're trying to accomplish with their children. They're just pretty much, more or less, waiting till they do their time, till they're 18, and then move them on, and there's no purpose for their parenting. I want to teach you about purpose with your parenting. Now go back with me to the book of Proverbs, and look at Proverbs chapter number 10. This is all by way of introduction. We'll get into the sermon here in a little bit, but let me read for you two more verses. Proverbs chapter number 10, and look at verse 1. Proverbs chapter number 10, and look at verse 1. Most people, if you ask a parent, and I would say all parents, unless they're just completely, you know, dumb, you know, not there, exactly. Most people would want to say that they'd like to raise a child that's going to make them proud. And look at what Proverbs chapter number 10 and verse 1 says. The Bible says, the Proverbs of Solomon, a wise son maketh a glad father. Do you see that? But a foolish son is the heaviness of his mother. That, let's read that again, because I want you to digest that verse. Proverbs 10:1. This is, by the way, this is the very first verse I memorized as a child. I was maybe 4 years old, and I remember my dad sat me and my brother down, and this was the very first verse he had us memorize, Proverbs 10:1. It's a good verse for a child to memorize. It says, the Proverbs of Solomon, a wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish son is the heaviness of his mother. Now go with me to Proverbs chapter number 15 and look at verse 20. Proverbs 15:20. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter number 15 and verse 20, a wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish man despiseth his mother. I'll read it for you again. A wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish man despiseth his mother. The truth is, we would all want to have a wise son who's going to make you glad, who's going to make you proud, who's going to be somebody you'd like to look at and be able to, you know, introduce your friends. This is my son. You know, I remember when we would have family Bible time with my dad and we'd get to verses like this, but I would always say this and I thought it was kind of funny, but there's probably some truth to it, you know, because if you notice it says, a wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish son is the heaviness of his mother. And in Proverbs 15:20 says, a wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish man despises his mother. You notice how the positive is always with the father, but the negative is always with the mother. You say, why is that? Well, that's easy. It's because men are better than women. No, I'm just joking. That's not it. You know, but my dad would always say this. He said, you know, it's funny, because if you have like a son who's like, you know, graduating as some doctor, you know, or if you got a son who's like, you know, did some, you know, he was some great hero, or maybe some great, like he did something great in the military, he saved all these people, you know, you're always going to see their dad there, you know, when they're getting their award, or they're getting their diploma, or whatever it is they're doing, you know, when they're being recognized, their dad, you know, he's going to put on his nice suit, he's going to put on his, dad's never worn a tie in his life, but he puts on a tie, even if it's a clip-on, and he goes down, because he's proud of his father, you know what I'm saying? But sometimes, you know, and I don't watch TV, and I don't have a television, but, you know, I don't know if you've ever seen when I was growing up, sometimes they put like live court cases on TV. And you know, my dad always pointed this out to me. It's funny, because when the, you know, you have this person who killed all these people, he did some horrible thing, and no one will be there to support them, but you always see this, a mom who's just crying. And because, you know, moms just have this tendency where they're just, they don't give up on their child. You know, a dad will give up on his child and just be like, that's not my son. You know, I don't want anything to do with it. But a mom, you know, your child could be the worst thing in the world and you're just always going to stick with it. You know, they could have killed all these people, done all these horrible things, and the mom's just going to be there. She's going to be supporting there. She's going to, even though she doesn't agree with it, you know, they're always going to be crying for their son. And that's why the Bible says that. It says, a wise son maketh a glad father. But you, really, a foolish son is always going to be a burden to their mother, because their mother's just never going to give up on them. Their mother's always going to love them. Their mother's always going to try to, you know, be there for them and stuff. But the truth of the matter is, none of us want a son or a daughter or a child that's going to embarrass us, you know. Or you want to have somebody who's going to be, you don't want a son who's going to grieve you or who you're going to be worried about. You want to be able to say, this is my son, and be proud of them. But here's the thing. Everybody wants that, but what we don't understand, like we read in Psalms, is that we have the power to make them princes. We have the power to raise them in a way where they will make us proud. Let's get into the sermon. Go back with me to Proverbs chapter number 29. Proverbs chapter number 29, and look at verse... Well, if you remember there, look at verse 18. Is where we started, Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, the people perish. But he that keepeth the law, happy is he. Now, we talked about having a vision for your children, having a purpose for your children, having a goal for your children. You ought to look at your child and realize, you know, what goal do I want for this child in the X amount of years I have with them? You know, I've got a 3-year-old and a 1.5-year-old, and they might be with me till they're 18, 19, 20, whatever it is, and I ought to look at those children and say, okay, I've got this child for the next 15 to 20 years or however long. You know, what do I want to accomplish with this child? You ought to have a purpose for your children. You ought to have a desire or a goal to see them. And the only way you're going to do that is by applying biblical wisdom. So let's start. Point number one is this: a purpose or purposeful in discipline. Purposeful in discipline. We're there in Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, the people perish. Look at the verse right before it. Now, you got to keep in mind, nothing in the Bible is by coincidence. There's nothing coincidental in the Bible. There's a reason why verse 17 is followed by verse 18, okay? Now look at what verse 17 says in Proverbs 29:17. It says, correct thy son. And look at what it says. And he shall give thee rest, yea, he shall give delight unto thy soul. You say, I'd like to have a son who's going to make me proud. I'd like to have a son who's going to make me glad. I'd like to have a son who's going to delight in me, you know, that I'm going to delight in my soul because of him. Well, how do you do that? Proverbs 29:17. You start off by correcting them. Bible says, correct thy son, and he shall give thee rest. Yea, he shall give delight unto thy soul. And by no coincidence, the next verse says, where there is no vision, the people perish. Now look, we can apply that verse, Proverbs 29:18, to a whole lot of things. To a vision in soul winning, to a vision in godly living, to a vision of whatever. But in its context, the verse is followed by this, correcting your son. I believe Proverbs 29:18 has to do with having a vision for your children. And the first step to having a vision for your kids, to having a purpose for your children, to making them princes and making them be somebody who you'll be proud of, is this: correction. Correct thy son, and he shall give thee rest. Yea, he shall give delight unto thy soul. Where there is no vision, the people perish. But he that keepeth the law, happy is he. One of the ways to raise a child that is going to give you delight unto thy soul is to discipline that child. Now, most people, and this is what I say, most people have no discipline or have no purpose with their discipline. You know, this is what I see. And if you've never seen this before, just go out to Walmart and just follow some family around. You know, don't follow them around, they're going to think you're stalking them. But just watch a family. Here's what you're going to see, all right? A child does something they're not supposed to do. And the mom says, don't do that. Then the child does it. Don't do that. Don't do that. And here's where most discipline comes in for most parents. They do nothing until the child upsets them enough for them to react. And then they just yell and scream at them or maybe smack them or whatever. You know, that's it. And look, let me tell you something. That type of discipline is discipline with no purpose. There's no point to that discipline except for this. Here's what the parent is trying to accomplish. I want the child to stop annoying me. You know what I mean? I want the child to stop bothering me. While they're doing this, it's upsetting me, and eventually it's going to upset me enough to where I react to them, but there's no point behind that other than, you know, just stopping whatever is annoying you. That's discipline with no purpose. You know, when you discipline with purpose, you have a goal. There is something you are trying to accomplish. And here's the thing with discipline, right? Like my son. If I tell him, son, I do not want you to do thus and so, and he does it, I ought not to just allow him to do whatever I said, told him not to do until he just makes me angry enough to where I just react and yell at him. You know, because with my disciplining, I may be keeping him from doing something, but really what I'm trying to show him is to obey. What I'm trying to show him is that, you know, actions have consequences. And there is a goal. When I discipline my children, I'm trying to teach them, hey, there are rules, there are boundaries, and when you cross those boundaries, there is a wage that must be paid because of that. And you should set boundaries or rules beforehand. And when your child crosses those boundaries, then you discipline them. And look, let me tell you something. There is always going to be emotion involved when you're disciplining a child. But you ought not be carried by your emotions in anger, okay? There ought to be some logic and some rational thinking that comes with it. That's why, you know, a child ought to be told, this is the rule. When you break this rule, here is the punishment. And then when they break the rule, actually fulfill the punishment. And that is discipline with a purpose, because you're actually teaching them something. All right? Now, go with me to Proverbs 23:13 and look at what the Bible says. We'll get into something a little interesting here. Proverbs chapter number 23, and look at verse 13. Proverbs 23:13, the Bible says, withhold not correction from the child, for if thou beatest him with a rod, he shall not die. Now look at the first part of the verse. Withhold not, is what the Bible says. Withhold not correction from the child. It is easy to withhold discipline. Because here's the truth. Look, I struggle with this myself. I'm upstairs working on something, you know, on a sermon or whatever. My wife's like cleaning something, making dinner. We tell my son, you know, whatever, don't do this. And then he does it. It would be easier for me to just ignore it, than stop whatever I'm doing and go deal with the situation. Because that's the flesh. But God says, withhold not correction from a child. God says, I want you to correct your child. And then look at the biblical mode of discipline. Look at what God tells us what discipline should be. Now I understand this goes against everything that our society teaches today. This goes against Oprah Winfrey. This goes against Dr. Phil. This goes against Dr. Spock. This goes against what the government teaches. But look at what God says. He says, withhold not correction from the child. And look what he says. For if thou beatest him with the rod, he shall not die. Bible says, if you beat the child with a rod, he shall not die. Now, let me, as a disclaimer, not a disclaimer, but just let me explain to you. When the Bible uses the word beat him with a child, it's not talking about beating up a child like abusing a child, alright? We are completely against abusing a child. You know, some drunken dad comes home and hits his child in the face, or, you know, smacks him around. That is abuse, and, you know, someone like that ought to have the fire beat out of him. Because, you know, you ought not abuse children, period. When the Bible uses the word beating him, it's talking about a good old-fashioned spanking. Now, let me tell you something. There's only one place in the body that you ought to spank a child, and that is on their bottom. All right? God has, you know, given us a part of a body, you know, body part of a child that has a little bit of cushioning on it, but also has a whole lot of nerves that will allow you to get that child's correction. And God says this, if you beat him with a rod, if you beat him with like a paddle or a stick, he says, look, he's not going to die. But we are not advocating by any means that you hit a child, that you beat a child, that you abuse a child. And look, let me tell you this. This is abuse also. The child does something that makes you mad, and he had no idea that that would make you mad, and then you just like scream and yell at him and you hit him. You know, you ought to tell, my son, if he does something that is wrong, but I've never explained that to him, this is what I'll say to him. Joshua, I don't want you to do whatever he did again. And if you do it again, I'm going to spank you. And then when he does it again, I just logically, calmly take him and discipline. No abuse. No screaming, no yelling, no cursing, no smacking him on the face, no kicking him, just, and then when we're done, my wife and I try to the best of our ability, we take him, we hug him, we tell him, son, we love you, but there are consequences to actions, all right? And God's mode of discipline is spanking. You say, well, that's not what the government told me, and that's not what, look, I don't care what the government says about anything. You know, the Bible says, if thou beatest him with the rod, he shall not die. Now, go with me to Proverbs 22:15. Let me show you another verse. Proverbs 22:15. You say, well, that's only one verse. Well, let's look at a few verses. Let's see what the Bible says. Proverbs chapter number 22, and look at verse 15. The Bible says, foolishness is bound in the heart of a child. Look, it's bound. A child is going to be foolish. Foolishness is bound in the heart of the child. And just remember that, because we're going to get back to that in a little bit. Foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, but look at what the Bible says. The rod of correction shall drive it far from him. So what is going to drive foolishness from the heart of a child? The rod of correction. That's what the Bible says. A good old-fashioned spanking is what's going to keep the child from being foolish in their heart. Go with me to Proverbs 13:24. Now, what about those who say, because people tell me this all the time. You know, they'll say, I don't know what kind of a parent you are, but I just love my child so much, I could never spank them. I could never hit my child. I love them so much. Well, let's look at what the Bible says, and let's see what God thinks about your loving heart. Because in Proverbs chapter number 13 and verse 24, the Bible says this. Look at what it says. And look at it very clearly. He that spareth his rod hateth his son. Do you see that? Isn't that amazing? God says, he that spareth his rod hateth his son. But look at what it says. But he that loveth him chasteneth him betimes. Isn't that amazing? See, the parent who actually spares the rod, the parent who actually withholds correction, God says, you don't love the child, you actually hate the child. He said, you actually hate your child. To not spank is to hate. To withhold the rod is to hate your child. Because, and you say, well, how does that, why is that? Because here's why, okay? My three-year-old son is learning something, okay? He's learning that if I do this, I will have this happen to me, and I don't like this to happen to me, so I'm not going to break this rule. Now, here's the thing. You come along, you know, with your bleeding heart and say, oh, I love my child too much. I could never spank them. I could never do something to them. So you withhold the rod, and you withhold correction. But here's the thing. You know who's not going to withhold the rod? It's the police officer. You know who's not going to withhold the rod? It's the drug dealer. You know who's not going to withhold the rod? And here's what you teach your child. You teach your 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18-year-old kid that they can do whatever they want, and there's no correction, there's no discipline, there's nothing that's going to happen to them. They can just mouth off, they can just do what they want, they can just skip school, they can just be late, they can do whatever, and nothing's going to happen to them. But here's what happened. One day they leave their loving parents and they go to the world, and when they show up late at work, you know what the boss says? I don't care what your mom said, you're fired because you're late. You see what I'm saying? They go to the world and the cop takes out a baton and beats them after death. And I'm not for cops doing that, but they're not going to spare the rod. The gang member's not going to spare the rod. The world is not going to spare the rod. You think the world has the same love for a child that you would? And when you teach your child to grow up like some punk with no discipline, with no character, with no work ethic, and you say, well, I just love him so much I can never spank him. Well, the thing is, you're setting them up for failure because the world doesn't care. The world doesn't care if they've got a sensitive heart, if they've got, if they're frail. The world could care less. And you spare the rod, but the cop's not gonna, and the world's not going to. So you better just start teaching your children now some discipline and showing them, hey, I love you, but there's consequences to actions. There's consequences to actions at our house because there are going to be consequences to actions out in the world. And that's the truth. And God says, he that spareth his rod hateth the son. But he that loveth him chasteneth him betimes. And you say, what does that word betimes mean? Because it says, if you look at the last part of the verse, it says, he that loveth him chasteneth him betimes. That word betimes there is an old English word. It means early, or in good time, or at an early period of time. The Bible says, but he that loveth him chasteneth him, he that loveth him disciplines him, he that loveth him corrects him. And here's what he says, betimes. He says, early. He says, in an early period of time. You say, when should I start disciplining my child? As early as possible. You know, obviously I'm not talking about some infant who doesn't understand, but even my son Joel, who's like a year old, you know, he understands. And even him will discipline. Now, we don't beat him with a rod. But, you know, even my son will get a little pat on his thigh when he does something wrong because he understands. He's like, well, he's too early. No. If you do it, betimes. Because here's the thing. You know that it's easier to get a 2-year-old to listen than a 12-year-old? I don't know if that's, that amazes you. But you know it's easier to get a 4-year-old to conform than a 14-year-old? You know that it's easier to get an 8-year-old to conform than an 18-year-old? And the thing is, most parents, here's where they lose the battle. They waste their time till their child grows up to be a punk. And by the time they're 17 and they're a loser, then you're trying to discipline. But look, you already lost the battle a long time ago. Because God says you should have started early in life. You should have started in a good time. You should have started at an early period of time. Go with me to Proverbs 19:18. Look at what the Bible says. Proverbs chapter number 19 and look at verse 18. Proverbs chapter number 19 and look at verse 18. Now look, this is good stuff. You kids ought to learn this and decide, you know, when I'm growing up and I've got a child, I'm not going to let them be like me. You know, some little punk. I'm just joking. But look at Proverbs 19:18. Look at what the Bible says. Proverbs 19:18. Proverbs 19:18. Chasten. That word chasten means to correct, to discipline, spanking. Chasten thy son while what? There is hope. He says, chasten thy son while there is hope, and let not thy soul spare for his crime. God says, look, while you have hope, while you've got time, while you've got a child that you can mold, that you can make a prince, he says, chasten him while you've got hope. And he says, and let not thy soul spare for his crying. You know, you'll spank your child, they'll cry like you just broke something. But you know what? Sometimes you just got to get to the place where you just spare not for his crying. And look, I'll tell you the honest truth. As a parent, I hate disciplining my children. Because here's the honest truth. I hate to see my child cry. I hate to see them in pain. But here's the thing. I'd rather inflict some pain now while it's supervised and teach them some character than have somebody else do it when they're old. Because they never learned discipline. Because they never got, corrected. Start young while there is hope. Start young while you've got hope. Be times, what the Bible says. If you start disciplining your 13-year-old, you're probably just too late. And let me tell you something. There comes an age where you ought not be spanking a child. You know, I'm not for spanking an 18-year-old or a 17-year-old, you know. By then, here's what happens with parenting. Here's what I've noticed. Parents who spank consistently throughout life will spank less and less and less and less. Okay? You spank a lot when they're 3 and 4 and 5 because that's when they're learning. They're learning boundaries. They're learning whether they can cross you. They're learning I'll tell you the honest truth. They're learning whether you're a pushover. But as you get older and they realize, no, daddy and mommy, they're serious. They're consistent. They're not lazy about it. You know, as they get older, you should start spanking less. You know, but you got to do it while there is hope. You say, I can't do that. Well, let me show you what God is not amused. Go with me to 1 Samuel in the Old Testament. We're gonna go back to Proverbs. But 1 Samuel in the Old Testament. And look at 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter number 3. 1 Samuel chapter number 3. God is not amused with the parent who will not restrain their child. God is not amused with a parent. God is not happy with a parent who will not discipline their children. Let me give you an example. 1 Samuel 3:12. We'll just read the verses. I don't have time to give you the context of the story. But the verses pretty much spell out what I want you to see. 1 Samuel chapter number 3 and verse 12, the Bible says this. In that day, I will perform. This is God speaking. I will perform against Eli all things which I have spoken concerning his house. So God had put a curse on the house of Eli. And God says, in that day, I'm going to do those things that I said I was going to do, that I have spoken concerning his house. When I begin, I will also make an end. He says, look, when I start disciplining Eli, I'm going to finish it. Here's what God says. Look at verse 13. For I have told him that I will judge his house forever. And look at what God says. I'm going to judge him forever for, that word for means because of, the iniquity which he knoweth, because his sons made themselves vile. And look what God says. And he restrained them not. You know that God completely cursed an entire house, which ended up the man died, his sons died, and a whole nation was punished. Because Eli, who was the high priest at the time, the spiritual leader of the nation, refused to restrain his son when he had knowledge of their sin. Isn't that amazing? And you have knowledge of your child's sin, and you refuse to correct it, God is not happy. God is not happy. Now go with me back to Proverbs chapter number 22, and we'll get off the subject of discipline, but we must be purposeful in our discipline, not just that. Number two, purposeful in our training. Purposeful in our training. Now go with me to Proverbs chapter number 22 and look at verse 6. Proverbs 22, 6, the Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Now, like I was saying earlier, most parents just live with their children. They care for their physical needs until the child is old enough to care for their own physical needs. But God says that you ought to be training your children. The Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he shall not depart from it. Now, you don't have to turn there. I'll just read this verse for you. Actually, you go to Deuteronomy chapter number 6, and I'm going to read a verse for you in Ephesians. Deuteronomy in the Old Testament, chapter number 6, and I'll read for you out of Ephesians. Ephesians, listen to this verse. Ephesians chapter number 6 and verse 4. The Bible says, and ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. And here's what God says. Listen up. I know you're going to Deuteronomy, but listen to what the Bible says. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. The Bible commands us to bring up our children, to raise our children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. You say, what do those words mean, nurture and admonition? Here's what they mean. Nurture means to feed and protect. It means to support and encourage. As during the period of training or development, foster. It means to bring up, to train, to educate. Admonish means to caution, to advise, to counsel against something, to reprove or scold, especially in a mild and good-willed manner. To urge to a duty, to remind, to admonish, that's what it means. God says He wants you to bring up your children in the nurture and admonition. What does that mean? God wants you to instruct your children. God wants you to teach your children. God wants you to train your children. Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way he should go. And look what it says. And when he is old, he will not depart from it. Are you there in Deuteronomy chapter number 6? Look at verse 6. Deuteronomy 6:6. You know, you got to take opportunities to teach wisdom to your children. You got to take opportunities to instruct your children. Look at what Deuteronomy 6:6 says. The Bible says, and these words, talking about the Bible, and these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shall, look what it says, shall talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up, and thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes, and thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house, and on thy gates. Now, does the Bible say that you're supposed to teach your children the Bible when they're in church on Sunday morning? Is that what it says? Now surely they are to get the Bible in church on Sunday morning. And surely they are to get the Bible in church on Sunday night. And surely they're supposed to get the Bible in church on Wednesday night. But God says He wants you to give them the words when thou sittest with them in thine house, when thou walkest by thy way, when thou liest down, when thou risest up. You know what God is saying? He wants you to be teaching your children the Bible all day long. You're in the car going to the store, you got to be talking about the Bible. You're waking up in the morning, you got to be praying with them, reading the Bible with them. You're going to bed, you got to be praying with them, reading the Bible with them. You're just going along in life and you got to be taking opportunities to teach your children the Bible. To teach them wisdom. To bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord to train up a child. And I've got to ask this question. How often do you take time to train your children? I'm not saying live with your children. I'm not saying take your children to school and take your children to store with you. But to actually speak to them and teach them something. Teach them how to be a good mother. Teach them how to be a good father. Teach them how to be a good housewife. A good homemaker. Teach them how to provide for their children. Teach them work ethics. But see, 99% of America, here's what happens. The kids go to school or daycare all day long. They come home and spend the rest of the night in front of the television or in front of a stupid video game that's just going to make them dumb. And that's what video games do. Look it up. They make children dumb. And we don't train, we don't admonish, we don't nurture, we don't instruct. And God says that He wants you to talk. He said, thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children. And thou shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. Take opportunities to teach wisdom to your children. That is purposeful parenting. That is parenting that is going to accomplish a goal that, but see, here's the thing. Most people don't have a goal. You ought to have a goal. You ought to have a vision for your children. You know what my vision for my children is? Your vision is that your child becomes the next president of the United States. Why would I want my child to... Have you seen the president of the United States? You think I want my child to grow up like Obama? No, sir. You know what my goal for my child is? Oh, you want them to be a doctor. You want them to be a governor. No, I want them to be godly. I want them to be holy. I want them to be powerful preachers of the Word of God. That's my goal for my children. So to accomplish that goal, here's what I'm going to do. Teach them the Bible. Train them in the Scriptures. Make them memorize the Bible. Take opportunities to teach them the Bible. If I wanted my son to grow up to be some baseball player, some famous shortstop, you know what I'd do? I'd go waste my life teaching him to be a shortstop. But that's a waste of a life. That yields no eternal rewards in heaven. If I wanted my son to be some politician, I'd teach him to lie, teach him to steal from people, teach him to, take people's money and give it to other people. That's what I teach him if I want him to be a politician. But I don't want him to be. I want him to be honest, so I'm going to teach him to work. Train up your child in the way he should go, is what the Bible says. Take opportunities to teach wisdom to your children. In order for your child, now here's the deep one. Go be to Proverbs chapter number 1. And here's the deep one. I know I'm going to give you time to digest it, because here's where it gets tough. In order for your child to receive instruction, it must be given instruction. Is that hard? Is that hard or what? In order for your child to receive instruction, someone has to be instructing them. Proverbs 1:8 says, "My son," this is Solomon speaking to his son. He says, "My son, hear the instruction of thy father, and forsake not the law of thy mother." Whose instruction is it? The father's instruction. Whose law is it? The mother's law. He says, "Hear the instruction of thy father, and forsake not the law of thy mother. For they shall be an ornament of grace unto thy head, and chains about thy neck." Go with me to Proverbs chapter number 7. Look at verse 1. Proverbs 7:1. Proverbs 7:1, the Bible says, "My son, keep my words, and lay up my commandments with thee. Keep my commandments and live, and my law as the apple of thine eye. Bind them upon thy fingers, write them upon the table of thine heart." So who's instructing? The father. Who's instructing? The mother. In order for your child to receive instruction, look, because you know, here's the funny thing about children. They're like sponges. You bring them to church like this, and you think they're not listening to anything. They're getting more than you think. And children learn more than you think. And if you instruct them, they'll receive it. But here's the problem with most kids. They're just not getting instruction. They just don't have anybody teaching them anything. And by the way, let me say this for the kids. It would behoove a child to listen. You don't have to turn there, but let me read for you a verse. This is one of the Ten Commandments. Exodus 20:12 says, "Honor thy father and thy mother." Now, that's pretty well quoted. Everybody knows that. But look at what the rest of the verse says. "Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee." You know that is the first commandment in the Ten Commandments that God attaches a promise to? And here's the promise, kids, listen up. God says, if you will honor, if you will respect, if you will obey, if you will love your father and your mother, here's what God promises he's going to do. That thy days may be long upon the land. God says he's going to give you a long life if you honor your father and your mother. Isn't that a great promise? And look, some of you better start taking it back, because I've seen the way you eat. And the way you eat, you'll be lucky to make it past 50. You know, all the candy and McDonald's and all this stuff, you know. I mean, honor your father and your mother. Obey your parents. Love your parents. And God says, I promise you, I'm going to give you a long life. You know, so it would behoove you to do that. Let me give you something practical here. You say, how should I instruct my family? Look, I believe in this. I believe in this so much. Have family Bible time. We did this when I was a child, and you ought to do it. Have family Bible time every day. You know, just pick out a day. Whatever works for you, morning or evening, you know, have family. My wife and I, we do it in the evenings. We you know, and we're not perfect at it. We need to get more consistent at it, and we're working on it. But we do it in the evenings. We do it every evening except for Wednesday night and Sunday night, because Wednesday night and Sunday night we're in church. But you know, around 8 o'clock, 8:30, we get our kids ready for bed, we put them in their pajamas, and then we have Bible time. Look, it takes like 10 minutes. It's not a full-blown sermon, all right? Here's what we do. Here's what we do with our family. And I'm just telling you what we do. You do it however you want to do it. But here's what we do. We'll sing a song, you know. Usually to begin with, we'll sing some sort of a fun song, you know. Something that they like. Like my son was singing "I Want That Mountain" for a week, so we would sing that song, you know. Then we'll read 1 to 2 chapters. He's 3 years old and 1 year old. You know, you're not going to keep their attention for a long time. So however long you want to. But we'll read a chapter in the Bible. Proverbs is what we've been doing. I'll talk about something in that passage for like 5 minutes. Just explain to them something. Then we'll sing a song, we'll pray, and we'll be done. You say, do you really think that's doing anything? Well, first of all, it's not going to hurt. Secondly, more time in the Bible is better for mom and dad as well. But they are learning, and they're going to learn. And you know what we're teaching our children? That the Bible is important. That we take time out of every day to give God the preeminence in our lives. That we, you know, we're teaching them, hey, the Word of God is important. Hey, mom and dad love the Bible. Mom and dad are consistent with the Bible. Mom and dad want to learn the Bible. That's what we're teaching them. But here's the hardest part of family Bible time. I'll tell you right now. The hardest part of family Bible time is this. Being consistent. And that's the hardest part of anything, you know. Just be consistent with it. and have family Bible, because God teaches you and instructs you to instruct your children. So point number one is purposeful in discipline. Point number two, purposeful in training or instruction. Point number three is this, purposeful in attention. Purposeful in attention. On purpose, spend quality time with your children. On purpose, spend quality time with your children. Do you remember Deuteronomy 6? You don't have to turn there again. But, you know, in order for you to fulfill Deuteronomy 6, let me read it for you. You don't have to turn there, but I'll read it for you. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up, and thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes, and thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house and on thy gates. In order for you to accomplish that, you know what you're going to have to do? Is spend time with your kids. You know, spend time on purpose with your children. Go to John chapter number 10 in the New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. John chapter number 10. Look at verse 2. John chapter number 10 and verse 2. You're going to have to spend time on purpose with your children. John chapter number 10 and verse 2. John 10, 2. The Bible says in John chapter number 10, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, it talks about the good shepherd, who's Jesus Christ. And I want you to see the example of the good shepherd. Because a shepherd is a leader. You're leading sheep. And in the same way, you as a parent are leading your sheep, which is your children. Look at John 10, 2. The Bible says, but he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter openeth, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calleth his own sheep by name, and leadeth them out. Now look what it says. He calls them by name, and he leadeth them out. And when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them. And the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. And a stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of a stranger. You know what a good shepherd does? He leads. The Bible says he leadeth the sheep. Okay? That means you're not just supposed to send them to church. You're supposed to take them to church. You're supposed to lead them to church. You're supposed to lead them on the way. You're supposed to, let me just explain something to you. Remember when we read that foolishness is bound in the heart of a child? And look, kids, don't get offended when I say this. Let me just explain to you something about children. Children are dumb. That's why they're children. You say, I'm so offended. Look, if I took a 10-year-old and put them in some city by themselves, they would die, you know. They can't support themselves. By the way, let me say this, because all the kids got offended. I know a lot of parents are dumb. In fact, most parents are dumb. You know, everybody's dumb. But here's the thing: a child needs to be led. Okay, here's where we have it backwards in America. Here's what I've seen all over America. You know, and when I watch families, is this: children lead the family, as opposed to the parents leading the family. You say, what do you mean? And look, I grew up in church my entire life. Since I was 7 years old, I've been out knocking on doors all over, you know, with my parents, with whatever, inviting people to church, giving people the gospel. When we were at different churches, I worked at bus ministries where we try to bring people to church. I've gone soul winning here at Verity Baptist Church for over the last 6 months. We've, you know, taken people to church and brought people to church. And here's what I found. For the most part, kids run the show in a house. Kids run a whole show. You know, here's where most play. If the kids want to go to church, then we'll go to church. If the kids don't want to go to church, we won't go to church. If the kids want to do this, we'll do it. If the kids don't want to do it, we won't do it. And you got to lead your children. The good shepherd leadeth the sheep. And you're not just sending them to church, you're going with them. Okay? Not only that, a good shepherd goes before them. Which also means you must be with them. Which means you must spend time with them. The sheep follow him. You know what that means? You tell them what to do, where to go, not vice versa. They don't tell you what they want to do, you tell them what to do, okay? You know, my children do not tell me what they want to do, I tell them what they're going to do. You know why? Because I'm the boss. You know why? Because I'm the one who's feeding them. Because they're living in my house, under my roof. I'm not living with them, so they listen to me. And kids, let me tell you something right now. Just listen up right now. Your mom and dad are the boss, period. If they say we're going to church, or they say you're going to church, or they say you're going to school, or they say you're doing this, hey, just do it. You all live a long life, you do it. It's not vice versa. Okay? Raising a child requires spending time with them. This is one of the reasons why I am totally against, and it's just one of the reasons, one of the many reasons, why I'm totally against daycare. Because, you know, I don't understand, and I will never understand, why people have children in order to give them to somebody else to raise for 8 to 9 to 10 hours a day while they go to, you know, work. You know, spend time with your children. Spend time with your kids. You gotta invest your life in your children. And most people spend time, you know, doing whatever instead of time with their kids, and then they wonder why they're raising a child who is mean, a child who is rude, a child who just does what they want. And here's the thing, because you're not disciplining them. If your child throws a fit, it's because you didn't discipline them. If your child, you know, if you say something stern to your child and they go in their room and they slam the door and they start throwing things, you've got a child who's got a bad attitude, and here's how you're going to beat the attitude, you know, or fix the attitude. Not by taking the television away. Not by taking the video game away. Here's how you do it. You take a rod and you spank them till they stop. Because look, a child only understands this, pain. You think I can reason with my 2-year-old or 3-year-old? You know, I can logic with him. Well, son, he only understands this, pain. That's it. When it hurts bad enough, he stops. You know, and eventually here's what he's going to figure out. It hurts bad enough, I'm not going to do it. And that's teaching him boundaries. Raising your child requires spending time with your children. And look, let me say this. Go back with me to, go with me to Luke. You're in John, right? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. So go with me to Luke right before the book of John. In John chapter number 1, look at verse 17. In John chapter number 1, look at verse 17. We're almost done. I've got like 3 more things I want to say. Look at Luke chapter number 1, look at verse 17. Luke 1:17. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. So just go back one book to the book of Luke. Chapter number 1, look at verse 17. Luke 1:17. The Bible says, "And he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias." And look at what God says. "To turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." You know, the Bible says that God wants to turn the heart of the fathers to the children. And then at the end of the verse, it says, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. God says, here's how you're going to prepare people for the Lord. Turn the hearts of the fathers to the children. You know what the sad thing is? That most parents' hearts are not turned to their children. Most parents' hearts are turned to their career. Most parents' hearts are turned to their social life. Most parents' hearts are turned towards their dating life. And God says, and he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children. And the disobedient to the wisdom of the just to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. That's what the Bible says. God says that he wants to your heart to be turned and spend time and invest into your children. Raising a child requires spending time. And look, let me tell you something. If you have I will never understand why somebody will have a child. I could not even fathom having a child, you know, my wife giving birth to a child and then taking that child to some daycare provider to 10 hours a day to raise that child. It makes no sense. You know, and there's a reason why my wife is a stay-at-home mom. Because I have children to raise them. We have kids to instruct them and to teach them. And my wife is never going to go get a job somewhere at the expense of our children. And look, we're not struggling, and God has blessed us, and God has given. But if God didn't bless us, I would eat, you know, rice and beans every day, and I'd work 3 jobs before my wife went and, you know, had a job somewhere where it caused her to be away from the children. Because God has given you those children to raise and to love and to instruct and to spend time with them. Don't put them in some daycare somewhere. And look, if I had a job that kept me, you know, away from my kids for extended periods of time, I'd get a new job. In fact, I did. I was in the military, you know, and you could get deployed and you became, and you know, I got out of the military. One of the main reasons is because it took you away from your family so much, you know. And people would tell me, like, are you an idiot? You know, you're coming out of the military with the economy, you're not going to be able to find a job, you're not going to be able to, but you know what, I just say, well, you know what, I'm going to let God deal with it, because God gave me this wife, and God gave me these kids, and I'll just let God deal with it. If he wants to feed us, then fine. But make your family and your children a priority. You say, I got this great job, but it keeps me away from my children, I can't spend time with them. Then get a new job. But don't sacrifice your children, because you must spend time with them to instruct them. And let me say this. And I hate even talking about this, but it's just so common in America, we've got to deal with it. If you're a divorced parent, you know, your priority needs to be your children, not dating, okay? And by the way, let me just tell you this. I know that this is completely amazing and nobody would, you know, I know like maybe three or four pastors who would even preach this. But let me say this. Getting a divorce and then remarrying is sin. I don't know if you know that. Let me just show you in the Bible, because I think, you know, sometimes I grew up away and I think everybody should know this, but they don't. Go with me to the book of Matthew, very first book in the New Testament, and look at Matthew chapter number 5 and look at verse 32. I'm going to show you two verses on this because they're just so vital. And especially with all the kids we got in the service this morning. Hey kids, let me teach you something right now. Don't get a divorce. God hates it. God hates divorce. Let me show you. Matthew chapter number 5 and verse 32. Look at what it says. Matthew 5, 32. But I say unto you, if you've got a Bible with red letters, this verse would be in red, because that means Jesus actually spoke this word. This is what Jesus said. I want to know what Jesus said. Let me show you what Jesus said about divorce. But I say unto you, that whosoever shall put away his wife, that's talking about divorce, saving for the cause of fornication, causes her to commit adultery. So when you put away your wife, your Bible says you're causing her to commit adultery. And look at what it says. And whosoever shall marry her that is divorced committeth adultery. Now look, I know that no one in America wants to say that anymore. No one in America wants to believe that anymore. I know that all across America, pastors are advising people to get divorced, to get remarried. But let me tell you something. At Verity Baptist Church, we believe in the truth of the Word of God. And let me tell you something. Jesus Christ said, whosoever shall marry her that is divorced committeth adultery, period. It doesn't get more clear than that. You say, well, my parents got divorced and they got me married. Well, look, honor them, love them, respect them. But let me tell you something. They're wrong. And don't you grow up and do that. Whosoever shall marry her that is divorced committeth adultery, is what the Bible says. Go up to 1 Corinthians chapter number 7. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. 1 Corinthians chapter number 7. Look at verse 10. 1 Corinthians chapter number 10. Look at verse 10. And let me tell you something. Truth is absolute. You know, on Wednesday night, we were talking about Pilate. When he looked at Jesus and he asked Jesus, what is true? And we know from John 14, that Jesus said, it is John 14. Where Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus said, I'm the truth. And Pilate was looking at Jesus, put his eyes on Jesus Christ, literally looking at the truth in flesh. And Pilate asked Jesus, what is truth? When he's looking at truth. You know why he did that? Because in this world, people don't believe in something being, you know, truth is just absolute. You know, people think truth changes based on circumstances. Well, yeah, it's wrong to get a divorce unless my wife, you know, committed adultery. Then it's okay. It's wrong to get a divorce unless my husband, you know, doesn't provide or hit me or whatever. Look, God says he's against it. All right? And it doesn't change. And I don't care who does it. I don't care if I get a divorce. It's still wrong. All right? Look at 1 Corinthians chapter number 7 and look at verse 10. 1 Corinthians 7:10, the Bible says, and unto the married I command. And look what he says. Yet not I, but the Lord. So who's commanding? The Lord. Let not your wife depart from her husband. He says, let not the wife depart from her husband. That's what it says. Look at verse 11. But and if she depart. Because we know that some people are just going to get divorced. He says, but and if she depart, look what God says. Look at the Bible. Let her remain unmarried. Or be reconciled to her husband. So what are your options? You say, I'm divorced. What do I do? Remain unmarried or get reconciled to your husband. Is what the Bible says. And let not the husband put away his wife. Look at verse 12. But to the rest speak I, not the Lord. If any brother hath a wife that believeth not, and she be pleased to dwell with him, let him not put her away. So he says, look, don't just divorce your wife or your husband because they're unbelieving. If they don't believe in Jesus Christ, but they want to, you know, they're well to please with you, Stay with them. But he says, if your husband or your wife leaves you, he says, remain unmarried. Or here's your option, reconcile to your husband. And look, I know that goes against everything that everybody teaches in America. But let me tell you something. At Verity Baptist Church, we still believe divorce is a sin. You say, well, what should I do if I've been divorced? Look, it's like any other sin. Confess it to God and don't do it again. Period. You know, it's just like lying, just like anything else. Just confess it to God and then just don't do it again. But God says that you ought to remain unmarried. And look, that's not going to change. I don't know how many people, I'll preach something like this, or somebody will ask me what I believe about it, and I'll show up clear from the Bible, and then like 2 weeks later, they're trying to convince me. They're like, well, see, in my situation is that I just can't be alone, or I've got this issue, and this person's going to, you know. And the thing is, you know, I feel bad and my heart goes out, but here's the thing. Truth doesn't change. The Word of God is true, and I'm never going to change on that. And I'm never going to be for an unmarried, divorced person. And look, let me just give you this warning right now. If you're divorced and you want to get married, don't ask this pastor to perform the wedding. Because I'm not going to perform the wedding. I'm not even going to attend the wedding. I'm going to keep my blender and not go. Because it's a sin. Period. And I don't care who does it. And look, and by the grace of God, I never will. But if I get a divorce, remember that I said this. It's still wrong. Truth doesn't change based on circumstances. True, and I know people who would have stood up behind the pulpit and preached against divorce, but are getting divorced today. Because they have no character. You know why they have no character? Because they had no parent who taught them and disciplined them from a child that they were supposed to do certain things, even if they didn't like it. And now they grow up and they say, well, I'm going to be married to so-and-so until I don't like it anymore. And then I'm just going to do what I want. Teach your children character so they don't grow up to be divorced. And you kids that are here that have never been married before, just listen to what I'm saying right now. Don't get divorced. And you know how you not get divorced? Here's how you not get divorced. Before you get married, you decide you're not going to get divorced. And here's how you do it. And here's the best thing. Look at the person that you're going to get married to. I'm giving you guys some great advice. Look at the person you're going to get married to. You girls, look at the guy you're going to marry one day. You guys, look at the girl you're going to marry one day. And just think in your head. If they did the worst thing I could think of to me, would I still forgive them? If they committed adultery on me, would I still forgive them? If that guy hit me because he was drunk one night, would I still forgive him and stay with him? And if the answer is no, then just don't marry them. You have no business marrying them because God says that it's wrong to get a divorce. But the reason I brought this up is this. I know so many divorced parents who will just throw away their children because their focus becomes their dating life. Their focus becomes their new girlfriend or their new boyfriend with their new daughter, with their new relationship. And they just forget about their children. And you know, your priority always needs to be your spouse and your kids. If your spouse is out of the picture, then your priority is your kids. All right? If you're divorced, raise your children. And stop running around like some 15-year-old trying to get a date somewhere and just realize that God gave you kids and you better train them right or you're going to raise some, you know, hellion. And that's what the Bible says. And I know that goes against everything that anybody teaches, but you know what? Verity means truth, and we're going to preach truth at this church. Raise your children with a purpose. Now, go with me and we're done. This is the conclusion of the sermon. Go with me to Proverbs chapter number 23. Look at verse 26. Proverbs 23:26. We'll look at one more verse. I'll make a few statements. We'll be done. Proverbs chapter number 23 and look at verse number 26. Proverbs 23:26. I'll read for you Luke 1:7 again. 1:17. But you go to Proverbs 23:26. The Bible says in Luke 1:17, and you shall go before him in the spirit and the power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Now, are you there in Proverbs 23:26? Look at what Proverbs 23:26 says. My son, give me thine heart and let thine eyes observe my ways. You know, God, a very wise person in the Bible, and it's part of the Bible, Proverbs 23:26 said to his son, give me thine heart. You know what you ought to say to your children? Give me thine heart. But here's the thing, here's the catch. It's easy to say, my son, give me thine heart, but here's the catch. My son, give me thine heart, and let thine eyes observe my ways. You know, we had there in that bulletin, where's that bulletin at? I like the quote that is said in the bulletin. To train up a child in the way he should go, travel that way yourself once in a while. That's a good quote. Because here's the truth. If you want your children's heart, they must observe your ways. And here's the thing about kids. They're not, you know, they're not deceived easily. They see things very clearly. You know, a child will know if your heart is turned towards them or if your heart is turned towards your new boyfriend or your new girlfriend. A child's going to know if your heart is turned towards them or if your heart is turned towards your career. A child is going to know if your heart is turned towards them or not. And they're going to observe your ways. But God says that you ought to ask your children to give me thine heart and let thine eyes observe my ways. Because they're going to know if your heart's turned toward them, their hearts it will be turned towards you. You say, well, what does that mean? Here's what that means. Let me explain that to you. You know why children go astray? You know why children sneak out and, you know, go get pregnant out of wedlock or go do drugs? Here's why. Someone else had their heart and not the parent. Does that make sense? Okay? Having their heart means you are the most important person in that child's life. That means that they will do anything for you. Okay? And here's the thing. If you allow your teenager to have friends, when that friend becomes more important to that teenager than you are, then that friend says, hey, sneak out with me. Hey, drink alcohol with me. Hey, do drugs with me. Hey, let's have sex before marriage. And they might think, well, mom doesn't like that. But because that friend has their heart and not mom and dad, then they do what that child says. That's it. You say, I've got a son he's got these friends and everything the friend tells him to do, he does it. But every time I tell him something, he doesn't do it. You know what the problem is? Those friends have his heart, not you. That's it. You got a child, you know, some kids have given their heart to their television or to their video game before they've given it to their parents. But see, you can't blame the child. It's the parent's fault if you don't have their heart. Because here's how you'll have their heart. Disciplining them, instructing them, spending time with them, loving them, training them for a purpose. Okay? My children are being guided. By the grace of God, they're going to attain their goal. They're being guided for a specific thing in life, to love God and to worship God and to do right by God. And everything, every influence we allow in their lives is guided towards that way. And that's why we purposely don't allow other influences in their lives, because I don't want anything else. Look, I will never put my... I grew up in Little League. I love Little League. I'm going to teach my kids how to play baseball, but I will never put my kids in a Little League. You know why? Because I don't want a coach or a team or a sport to have their heart before I got their heart. Does that make sense? You as a child, you as a parent need to have the goal of having your child's heart. Because when you have your child's heart, you'll be able to love them. But here's how you do it. You start young and you just invest your life into it. You redeem the time, for the days are evil. Bible says that our life is but a vapor. It vanishes, you know, it appears for a little while and it vanishes away. You've only got, you know, it sounds like a long time, 15 years, 20 years, but it's so fast. It goes by so fast. You know, you blink and they're grown up. You've only got so much time and you waste it on other things. You waste it on that job. You waste it on that, you know, relationship, that social relationship, whatever it is. You're going to regret it. I'm telling you right now, you're going to regret it. Train up a child in the way he should go. And when he is old, he shall not depart from it. But there's a difference between parenting and parenting with a vision, parenting with a purpose, parenting with a goal set in mind. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you, Lord, so much. Thank you for our church, Lord. And Father, I do ask that you would help everybody in the service to have learned something, Lord. And I know that your spirit can help us apply things differently for different people. But Lord, we need in America to raise children with a purpose. And that doesn't mean that we're perfect. That doesn't mean that we're not going to make mistakes. That doesn't mean that we're not going to do things that maybe we shouldn't have done. That doesn't mean that we may not show our kids things that maybe later in life we'll regret. But through the course of our life, we ought to have a purpose for our children, a vision for our, not just our children, but our family, our spouse, our neighbors, our friends, anybody and everybody who would allow us to influence their lives. Lord, help us to have a disciplined life so that we can teach others to have a purpose for their life. We love you, Lord, in your precious name, I pray. Amen.